Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Today, we will discuss about landscape interaction. The objective of this lecture is to classify the type of organism occupying an area based on the water movements and characteristics. Number two, to describe the organism that inhabit the river ecosystems based on two river concepts. And number three, to assess the influence of climate and watershed, atmospheric, soil erosion, and sediments on the water bodies. This is the functional differences between lotic and lentic. This is for lotics, for example, streams. Okay, the water in lotic ecosystem is transit almost immediately. The energy fixed primarily in the watershed, and most of the organism can be found near or on the substrate. For the lentic ecosystem, for example, lake, water can be retained for days or months or years. The energy are fixed primarily in the lake, and most organisms are suspended in the water column. Characteristic of the two types of the water bodies, namely lentic and lotic, are closely linked to their catchment or watershed and airshed. Input of organic matter from outside sources, or also known as allotrophs, or within themselves, autochthonous. These water bodies are sink for human waste. The watershed, also called the drainage basin, is all of the land and water areas that drain towards a particular river or lake. Thus, a watershed is defined in terms of the selected lake or river. They can be sub-watershed within watershed. For example, a tributary to a lake has its own watershed, which is part of the larger total drainage area to the lake. A lake is a reflection of its watershed. More specifically, a lake reflects the watershed size, topography, geology, land use, soil fertility, and erodibility and vegetation. The impact of the watershed is evident in the relation of nutrient loading to the watershed. The impact of the watershed is evident in the relation of nutrient loading to the watershed lake area surface area ratio. Typically, water quality decreases with an increasing ratio of the watershed area to lake area. Why? This is obvious when one considers that as the watershed to the lake area increase, there are additional sources and volume of runoff to the lake. In larger watersheds, there is also a greater opportunity for water from precipitation to contact the soil and leach minerals before discharging into the lake. Lakes with a very small watershed that are maintained primarily by groundwater flow are known as seepage lakes. In contrast, lakes fed primarily by inflowing streams or rivers are known as drainage lakes. In keeping with the watershed lake area relationship, seepage lakes tend to have good water quality compared with drainage lakes. However, lakes are often more susceptible to acidification from acid rain because of their low buffering capacity. If you look at a map of rivers and streams, you can see they make different kinds of patterns called drainage patterns. Drainage patterns tell us something about the land the rivers are flowing over. There are 8 types of drainage pattern, namely dendritic, parallel, trellis, rectangular, radial, annular, multibasinal, and contorted. These drainage patterns are influenced by overall topography and underlying geologic structure. There are 4 dimensional concepts or connectivity of the structure with the catchment. The profile are based on 1. Lateral, 2. Longitudinal, 3. Vertical, and 4. Temporal. There are 4 ways that the river connects with the catchment. Number 1 is lateral. In lateral dimension, the river links with the riparian vegetation, riverbanks, and the floodplain. For the longitudinal dimension, it's like the water moved downstream. So, there is also the downstream movement of nutrient, sediment, chemicals, and animals, and also the upstream movement of the migrating fish. For the vertical dimension, is a link between river with the groundwater system under the water. Invertebrates and some fish species found in tiny spaces between the sediment underneath the river. For the temporal, is related to time. It's related to time. Rivers and streams are connected. It's related to, it's a combination between longitudinal. It can be longitudinal, it can be lateral, it can be vertical connect a connection, but it's also editing. It's also editing another dimension. It's time. Okay, I think I hope you understand that it's a relationship, probably longitudinal with lateral, or maybe only longitudinal relationship, but it's related to time. In spite of the fact that strains vary widely, most strings corridors have three major components in a cross section, namely strain channel, which is shear, flat plane is here, and transitional upland fringe. As mentioned before, there are three major components of a stream. Number one is stream channel, a channel with flowing water at least part of the year. Number two is flat plane. It's a highly variable area on one or both sides of the stream channel that is inundated with flood waters at some interval from frequent to rare. Number three is transitional upland fringe. It's a portion of the upland on the landward side of the floodplain that serves as a transitional zone or edge between the floodplain and the surrounding landscape. In many river corridors, a more complex assortment of features can be seen. In the example, the floodplain is seasonally inundated and includes features such as floodplain forests, emergent marshes, and wet meadows. This river's transitional upland fringe includes an upland forest and a hill prairie. Landforms such as natural levees are created by processes of erosion and sedimentation, primarily during floods. The various plant communities possess unique moisture tolerance and requirements, and consequently occupy distinct positions relative to the stream. As you can see here, this is the wet phase of Danau Sentarum in January 2004. And this is a dry phase of Danau Sentarum in 1994. So you can see here there are some areas that are under the water during wet phase, mostly from the floodplain area. This is the main channel. Okay, and then this is the floodplain area, which is flooded during wet phase. The overall longitudinal profile of most streams can be roughly divided into three zones, namely zone one, also known as headwaters, zone 2, also known as transport zone, and zone 3, also known as depositional zone. Zone 1, okay, or headwaters, often has a steepest gradient. Sediment erodes from slopes of the watershed and move downstream. Zone 2, the transport zone, receives some of the eroded material. Okay, it is usually characterized by the wide floodplains and meandering channel patterns. Okay. The gradient flattens in zone 3, the primary depositional zone. Though the figure displays the headwater as mountain streams, these general patterns as changes are also often applicable to the watershed with relatively small topographic relief from headwaters to mouth. It is also important to take note that erosion, transfer, and depositional occur in all zones, but the zone concept focuses on the most dominant process. This figure show the changes in flow, sediments, and channel size characteristics throughout the longitudinal profile tree zone. Okay, so from headwaters to depositional zone, from here to here, this is headwater, this is transfer zone, this is deposition zone. So from headwaters to depositional zone, the slope gradient decrease, the slope gradient decrease, the mean flow velocity decrease, the bed material grain size decrease, the stream discharge increase, the volume of stored alluvium increase, the channel width increase, and the channel depth increase. This slide show the flow condition for rivers and stream. Number one is base flow, minimum quantity of water in the channel. It comes from precipitation that percolates to the groundwater and moves slowly through substrate before reaching the channel. Number two is frequent floods. Every two-year return interval, reset the river system by flushing fine material from the stream bed and facilitate dispersal of organism. In rare or extreme event, it happens in 50 or 100-year floods. It's a reformative event for the river system. There are also seasonal timing of flows, especially high flows, critical for the reproduction of several native species. For the annual variation is year-to-year variation in runoff volume that influence the river system. These are the stream category, okay? There are three categories of a stream, okay? Number one is ephemeral, which flow only during or immediately after rainy season and flows less than 30 days per year. Number two is an intermittent stream, which flow only during certain time of a year, lasts more than 30 days per year. And the third category is perennial, which flow continuously during wet and dry season. This is the base flow. The base flow is generated from groundwater into the channel. This is stream order, or also known as stream ordering. It's a method of classifying or order the hierarchy of natural channels within a watershed. Okay, is what it was developed by Horton in 1945, and several modifications of the original stream ordering scheme have been proposed, but the modified system of Strahler in 1957 is probably the most popular today. The Strahler stream ordering system is well-known classification based on stream relationships. Okay, the uppermost channel in the drainage network, for example, a headwater channel with no upstream tributaries, are designed as the first order streams down to their first confluence. A second order stream is formed below the confluence of the two first order channels. Third order streams are created when the two second order channels join, and so on. Note in the figure that the intersection of a channel with another channel of lower order does not raise the order of the stream below the intersection. Within a given drainage basin, stream order correlates well with other basin parameters such as drainage area or channel length. Consequently, knowing what order a stream is can provide clues concerning other characteristics such as which longitudinal zone it resides and relative channel size and depth. The vegetation across the stream is based on the different hydrologic and soil condition. The riparian vegetation of smaller streams might form a closed canopy above the channel. Submerged aquatic macrophytes will grow if the substrate and stream velocity allow for rooting, for example, water lily, cattail, and duckweed. Floodplains may support herbal plants, small shrubs, and tree seedlings temporarily, and transitional uplands may have established forests. Flood pass concept. This concept demonstrates how flooding processes, plants, and wildlife in all parts of the stream corridor interact. Floodplains serve as essential focal points for the growth of many riparian plants communities and the wildlife they support. Some riparian plant species such as willows and cottonwoods depend on flooding for regeneration. Flooding also provides floodplains with sediments and nutrients and provide habitat for invertebrate communities, amphibians, reptiles, and fish spawning. This concept was developed to summarize how the dynamic interaction between water and land is exploited. This concept was developed to summarize how the dynamic interaction between water and land is exploited by the aquatic and terrestrial river corridor biota. Applicable primarily on larger rivers, the concept demonstrates that the predictable advance and retraction of water on the floodplain in a natural setting enhances biological productivity and maintains diversity. The river continuum concept is an attempt to generalize and explain longitudinal changes in the stream ecosystem. This concept is not only helps to identify connection between the watershed, floodplain, and stream system, but it also describes how biological communities develop and change from the headwaters to the mouth. The water continuum concept can place a site or reach in a context within a larger watershed or landscape, and thus help practitioners define and focus restoration goal. This is the river continuum concept. As you can see here, from the headwater to the river mouth, you can see the relative channel width is expanding. And then there are different categories of insect communities from headwaters to the river mouth. Okay, namely shredder, scraper, and collector. The river continuum concept hypothesize that many first to third order headwater streams are shaded by the riparian forest canopy. This shading in turn limits the growth of algae, periphyton, and other aquatic plants. Since energy cannot be created through photosynthesis, the aquatic biota in this small stream is dependent on allotonous material, which is a material coming from outside the channel, such as leaves and twigs. The biological communities are uniquely adapted to use externally organic inputs. Consequently, these headwater streams are considered heterotrophic, which is dependent on the energy produced in the surrounding watershed. Temperature regimes are also relatively stable due to the influence of groundwater recharge, which tend to reduce biological diversity to those species with relatively narrow thermal niche. Predictable changes occur as one proceeds downstream to fourth, fifth, and sixth order streams. The channel widens, which increases the amount of incident sunlight and average temperatures. Levels of primary production increase in response to increases in light, which shifts many streams to a dependence on autochthonous material, which is materials coming from inside the channel or internal autotrophic production. In addition, smaller pre-processed organic particles are received from upstream section, which serves to balance autotrophy and heterotrophy within the stream. Species richness of the invertebrate community increases as a variety of new habitat and food resources appear. Invertebrates functional groups, such as the grazers and collectors, increase in abundance as they adapt to using both autochthonous and allotonous food resources. Mid-sized streams also decrease in thermal stability as temperature fluctuation increase, which further tends to increase biotic diversity by increasing the number of thermal niche. Larger streams and rivers of 7 to 12 order tend to increase in physical stability, but undergo significant changes in structure and biological function. Larger streams develop increased reliance on primarily productivity by phytoplankton, but continue to receive heavy inputs of dissolved and ultra-fine organic particles from upstream. Invertebrates population are dominated by fine particle collectors, including zooplankton. Large streams frequently carry increased load of clays and fine silts, which increase turbidity, decrease light penetration, and thus increase the significance of heterotrophic process. The influence of storm events and thermal fluctuation decrease in frequency and magnitude, which increase the overall physical stability of the stream. This stability increase the strength of biological interaction, such as competition and predation, which tends to eliminate less competitive taxa and thereby reduce species richness. This concept also have disadvantages. The fact that the river continuum concept applies only to perennial streams is a limitation. Another limitation is that disturbance and their impacts on the river continuum are not addressed by the model. Disturbance can disrupt the connections between the watershed and its streams and the river continuum as well. The river continuum concept has not received universal acceptance due to this and other reasons. Nevertheless, it has served as a useful conceptual model and stimulated much research since it was first introduced in 1998. Why fishes breed after the rainfall? Okay, why? Rainfall will increase the water level and the floodplain will be flooded. And diffusion of nutrients from sediment through the contact between water and floodplain. Submerged vegetation on floodplain will decompose and will recycle nutrients to the water column. Nutrients will help plankton to bloom, thus provide food to the fish larvae, and this become new habitat within the floodplain. The influence of climate and watershed on river. Parent rock, climate, topography, and vegetation cover will determine the composition of waters. Soft water, rainwater, is a granite or volcanic area. For hard water, is a sedimentary rocks. Withering and dissolution rates of mineral are influenced by climate. Extreme heat and cold speed up the withering process by cracking rocks and altering the soil condition. Basin topography controls and regulates erosion. Large drainage basin collect more dissolved nutrients. Vegetation in the watershed modifies the soil water quality. For example, nitrogen cycle, nitrogen gas fixing plant, which is a symbiotic bacteria or leguminous symbiotic bacteria. The A-shed or rainwater is an important source of chemicals for aquatic ecosystem, which contains sodium and halogens, which is higher near seacoast. Iodine is essential for thyroid gland function. Water has great affinity for ammonia in atmosphere. Fires, dust storm, and volcanic activity are major contributors. Dust contain absorbed nitrogen, phosphorus, and trace metal. This is the influence of soil erosion and sediments on water. Timber harvesting and urbanization supply sediments to water bodies. This leads to turbidity increase and kill fish or affect the respiration by clogging gills, destroy spawning ground, bury submerged plant, poor visibility for predation. Sediments in water bodies act as sites for an ion exchange between aquatic and solid phases. This may disturb the dynamic buffering system between sediments and surrounding water. Removal of vegetation accelerate the loss of sediments and soluble plant nutrients. Forest fires produce ash rich in minerals, increase water fertility. And then fertilizers, which came from golf courses and agriculture, will lead to extra nutrients in the river. For that, this is the end of the lecture. Thank you.